Good evening, students. Welcome to Dr. Kalam IAS Academy. Let us continue the discussion with respect to the topic Citizens Charter. Can anyone just brief what is Citizens Charter, which we have discussed yesterday? What is Citizens Charter? A very, very important thing. Already in UPSC examination, they have asked once. Okay, who is a citizen? What do you understand by charter? Dear students, this is a very, very important concept. Please do internalize these things. Please concentrate. Citizen charter evolved for the first time. It came into existence in the present form. It came into existence in the present form in 1991 in UK. In India, it was in 1997. Citizens means you will be having three important things. Who are citizens? Citizens are those who have got rights. Citizens are those who have got the obligation of obeying the law and also carrying out their duties. Charter means something which grant authority or rights. So we can say that citizen charter is equal to citizens' rights. Citizen's charter refers to set of commitments made by an organization with respect to the standards of service which it delivers. This is a very, very important. If you forget anything in this chapter, it's okay. But if you forget these two lines, it's not okay. Citizens' Charter represents a set of commitments made by any organization with regard to the services which it delivers. Right? The famous quote with respect to this Gandhi, it's important because it is there in second RC. Please go through it. What are the features of Citizens Charter? Very important. The heart of Citizens Charter. What is the heart? What is the heart and soul of Citizens Charter? Next question which you have to internalize is, are Citizens Charters enforceable in the court of law? What are Citizens Charters? These are set of commitments. What if these commitments are violated? Are they enforceable in the court of law? In case of default, what will be the due course of action? These form the three basic things on which you have to build up this concept, right? At the heart of Citizen Charter is the commitment given by a service providing organization. Citizens' charters are not enforceable in the court of law. This is a very, very important thing. Citizens' charters are not enforceable. These commitments given by the service providing organizations are not enforceable in the court of law. That should be very clear. Not any court of law, but in case of default, a suitable remedial measure is provided. Is this clear to you? They are not enforceable in the court of law, but if there is any default, if something goes wrong or the commitments are not upheld, then there is a suitable remedial measure mechanism provided. This is the third one, is the one which most of the students forget. In case of default, there is a suitable remedial mechanism. If the commitments are not satisfied, right? What is the importance of Citizens Charter? In this regard, you can ask questions to make the concept clear. How Citizens Charter empower the citizen? So then it will indirectly be dealing with the importance. Are Citizens Charters driven by demand or supply? what is the basis for this public services provided by citizen charter service providing organization? Is citizen charter an end in itself, or citizen charter is of instrumental value? Is it a tool? Is it a mechanism? Or just having a citizen's charter is an end? These are very, very important. Citizen's charter empower the citizens in demanding committed standards. So when you have given, when the service organ providing organization has given the commitment, when you have given something written, something like very conspicuously you have mentioned that these are the commitments which I will be fulfilling, it empowers the citizens to demand those standards. Say, for example, GHMC, Greater Hyderabad Municipal Corporation, it has come up with a citizens' charter. My took is, this is one of the best method around India where which I have found. They collect garbage, chatta. They collect garbage door by doorstep, at your doorstep. This is one of the feature you won't find anywhere. Even if you are staying in fourth floor, they will come to your house. They will knock, chatta ma chatta. Because I was there. In other cities, it is not there. There will be some vehicle. It will blow the horn whenever it comes. All have to dump the things. It's not there. Example, if it gives commitment that every day there will be one person who will be coming to your house and they will be taking the garbage. If that is the commitment which they have given, if they don't satisfy that, then you can demand. Enter by meer ila chepparu meer cheyatledu. You can ask endukandi ila chestunaru. So you can demand. Why? Because there is a commitment already you have given. It is very open. It is not something subtle. It's very conspicuous. So by this way, it is empowering the citizens. It is demand driven, not supply driven. Means citizens' charter are driven by the demands of the people, what people want. It's not about what your representative or service provider wish to give. It is what people want. It is driven by demand. It sees public services through the eyes of those who use them. While forming citizens' charter, what are the things, main things which you have to keep in mind? I am a person who is living in Hyderabad. What are the difficulties I will be facing with respect to garbage? I'll be in anywhere. So keeping that in view, we have to prepare citizens' charter. They cannot be an end in itself. It is a means to an end. Please understand a very, very important thing. Citizen, this question is in hopping. It may be asked anytime. They cannot be an end. Citizen charter cannot be an end in itself. Why citizen charter cannot be an end in itself? They're just means to an end. Then what is the end? That is the very important thing which you have to ask. Citizen charter is just a tool. Citizen charter is just a tool. It is just a mechanism. That ensures citizen is always at the heart of any service delivery mechanism. So what is the end? The end is to keep the citizen at the center of any service delivery, citizen-centric service providing. citizen centric government. For this, your citizen's charter is only a means, only a tool, only an instrument. It is not the end, it is not the goal, right? Other general things, when there is a commitment, it leads to, it makes the organization transparent. Since you have already given the commitment, you can hold the organization accountable. Since these are made, keeping in view, if these are driven by the demand, it will be citizen friendly. Apart from this, and before I forget, dear students, all the points which I'm mentioning here are taken from second ERC report. So they are very, very authenticated. So internalize these things as given. Right. Six principles of citizen charter movement. What are they? They are very, very pretty simple, pretty easy, common sense things. One is quality. Improving the quality of service, then choice for the users wherever possible. You have to give choice to them. Say, for example, one is affordable, like one can afford giving 100 rupees, give him that. One is not capable of giving 100, is capable of giving only 10, giving. There are many other who want the things for free, give them. So you should have choices. You can't give only Maruti and 100 for all citizens. Someone bends. You feel that they are polluting, tax them. But you have to give choice. This is a very, very important. Standards specifying what to expect within a time frame. So here, what you are providing and also with respect to a time frame. Value for taxpayers' money, a very, very important thing, often overlooked. See here, value for taxpayers' money. Here, in the name of providing services, you cannot use the taxpayers' money the way you want. Say, for example, for any slum development or anything, here, it is not only connected to that slum. It is not only connected to that service. It is in the larger taxpayers' interest. A program may be for weaker section of the society. Here, you cannot use the taxpayers' money the way you want. It should be very judiciously used. Accountability of service provider and transparency in rules, procedures, schemes, and grievance redressal mechanisms. Dear students, this is a very, very important aspect. You make some acronym with this, all the six principles, and you have to remember this. There is no other way for this. So this is very, very important: quality, choice, standards, value, accountability, and transparency. Come up with an acronym, just one, very easy to remember. That is the only way to remember. Otherwise, you will be forgetting these things again and again. Citizens' Charter, status and problem. After going through all the things in second ARC, I have found these things pertinent. What are they? What is the status and problem with respect to citizens' charter? Poor design and content. In the design itself, there is a lack of standard. What are the reasons for this poor design? Why they are so not contextual? I'll be reciting the reasons. Next is lack of public awareness. See, almost all service providing organizations are having citizens' charter. I repeat, all the citizens, almost all, service providing organizations are having citizens' charter. Do you know the citizens' charter of your municipal corporation? Do you know the Citizen Charter of police organization? Do you know the Citizen Charter of a bank? Do you know the Citizen Charter of GHMC? Do you know the Citizen Charter of any vehicle authority or anything like that? See, you are the one of the most knowledgeable person. That is the reason you are here. A person who thinks of preparing civil service is having minimum knowledge. See, you are not aware of all these things. What about the general public? When people are not aware that they exist, how can they demand? This is the greatest lacune. All service providing organizations are having citizens charter, my dear students. All departments have citizens charter. Next. In preparation of the citizens charter, there is no adequate groundwork. There is no adequate groundwork with respect to collection of data, with respect to knowing what are the problems, what are the lacunes. Charters are rarely updated, a very, very important thing. Whenever a program comes or when something new comes, they comes up with a charter, but they never update because it's in their own interest. Because if they go on updating the things, they have to give more commitments. Right? End users and NGOs are not consulted when the charters are drafted. People or the NGOs who are involved in providing services, they are not consulted. Without their consultation, just apply this thing to you. GHMC, you are residing in a metro. Did any of the GHMC official came and asked you that these are the things we are preparing a citizens charter? What are your inputs? They never consulted you. The need of senior citizens and the disabled are not considered when drafting the chart. And the officials, the service providing organizations have resistance to change. So this is a status and problem. For this, what is the solution? Is civil society. Civil society organizations should be aware, should be empowered. In any democracy, wherever the civil society is strong, corruption is very less. Wherever the civil society is vibrant, wherever the people are more knowledgeable, when they know about their rights and duties, democracy will be very good. Otherwise, democracy won't be that good. Almost like one third of all your MLA MPs are having criminal charges. You are making a criminal your representative. You are making a criminal a representative. How can you expect good governance? Dear students, a very, very unfortunate thing here is we are all carried away by some other way with caste, religion, all these things. We are not giving more importance to the noble virtues one should have. Yediyurappa, you went to jail. Okay, inka evaru poleda? That is the question they ask. They're not asking like Yediyurappa, okay, let's not take the name, some may get hurted. Similarly, wherever you go, all are having, why are you making them? Don't make those things. Civil society should be very, very vibrant. Then only all the things will be right. Next set of the things, still not being adopted in all the ministries and departments. Here, this is one of the limitations to a very less extent, because it was like around 10 years back when second ARC reports came. So now, not all have come. There are few, you can say that. Still few ministries and departments have not adopted. You can make that. So only few ministries are left out. Now all the ministries and departments have come up with citizenship charter. Has become a one-time exercise, as I told you. Once they come up with the citizenship charter, finish. They won't revise those things. Divide of participative mechanism. There is no mechanism where they can involve people. Service providers are not familiar with the philosophy of the citizenship charter itself. Service providers, those who provide, they don't know for why citizenship charter. The philosophy behind the citizenship charter cannot avail. Right. Another important thing you have to note, say for example, you take it example or the real case study. It is presented in second ARC. So I'm presenting you. A Transparency International India study team found that except for banks, see, this is a very, very important thing. According to Transparency International study, except for bank, none of the service providers displayed any citizen charter. So that is the reason in the beginning itself I told, in some banks, they will be displaying the citizen charter. In any service providing organization, none of them have displayed the citizen's charter, whether it is in your PDS, public distribution system, your electricity. In hospital, did you see conspicuously in any hospital, like these are the services we will be providing. If you, like if these services are not provided, whom you have to approach? No, water supply, housing, land record, registration, police, targeted schemes. So to say, except banks, in none of the things. The other way implication is, these are the areas where they have to be present, hospitals, water, housing, land record, everywhere. All the departments and ministries should have a citizen's charter. But though they have, they are not displaying the thing. A great defect in citizen's charter. This is one of the major defects. And this is a reason why you don't have awareness about citizens' charter. Next, a very interesting example. Trains in Europe, they provide compensation for late running. So in Europe, they provide compensation if the trains are running late. You can take the example also, Thales International, a train in Europe, or Eurostar, a train between France and the UK. So here, if the train comes late, or if the train gets cancelled, they will compensate the passengers. So if this is adopted in India, what will be the situation? Then definitely, like, people will go to buy the ticket to get the compensation itself, because all will get the compensation. In India, trains running late is a rule. If it is coming in time, means it is an exception. Right. One more, since it was a point in context. In India, the trains are not that efficient, because major problem is we have got only one line. We have got only one line. Means, say for example, a train has to come from this side. So it has to take the same rail. And another has to come from this area, from this direction, it also has to take the same place. So you can imagine how difficult it is. Well, sometimes trains will be kept in some areas and they say that passing, yeah. Passing. What is that? Means some train will be passing, it's not possible. So my dear students, in India, there is a need of two lines. In metros, you might have seen. In metro, there are two lines. One for one side, another for another side. So it will be very, very important if all the trains, train routes are having two lines. This is all about your citizens' charter. Like I have covered extensively, still elaborately I'll be giving for material, everything which is given in the second ARC, you can go through that. You can answer any question from this information. No question will be out of the material, the things what I am telling you. With respect to citizen chapter, it is exclusive. Right. Next is ethics in private and public relations. We have discussed this concept in general. Let us exactly see what are these things. Let us understand what is private relation, what is public relation. Here, would anybody like to give any like information with respect to private relations? What are the private relations? What are the public relations? It's a general common sense, straightforward question. Private relations. Please go ahead.
Friendship.
Okay, friendship. Good. Only one.
Cousins, siblings.
Cousins, siblings. Okay. Public relation.
In organizations.
Organizations. Okay. Okay. Then once again, please think it over. It's all about reflection. Ethics is a reflective science. Ethics means set of standards. What are the standards you expect in private relations? What are the standards you expect in private relations and public relations? This is at the heart of this topic. Think it over. You have married. What relation, what is the standard you expect from your husband, your wife? You have got children, or you have got father and mother. What is the standard you expect there? That's it. There's nothing more in this one. Are you getting me? See, I have made the concept clear to you. Ethics means set of standards. So what are the standards which should rule private relations? What are the standards which should rule public relations? This is the whole story. Right. Let me explain these things in a systematic way. Some of the things which are not common. So this is a question in 2019. What are the basic principles of public life? Illustrate any three of these with suitable examples. What are the basic principles of public life? So in this, think it over. One of the most important thing which you often forget is self. Self is the most, and if there is any private relation, the apex, the climax, and the core of private relation is self. This is the one most of the students forget. Okay. Then please think it over. Are all these having the same kind of relation, or is there anything different? Self, family, friends, acquaintances means a person whom you know slightly, boyfriend, girlfriend, living relation, a relation between a teacher and student, a relation between your neighbor, a relation between the people in a village, the relation between a colony in a city. Among them, which are private, which are public, think it over. Private relations are personal relations, and there is primary relation. These are the primary relations. These are one-to-one relations. These are face-to-face relations. These primary relations are based on customs, tradition, religion, trust, marriage, blood, friendship. So how it is based? It is based on trust. Mother, father, how it is made? By blood. Husband, by marriage. So these relations are based on customs, traditions, religion, trust, marriage, blood. These are one-to-one relations. When you say that is a private relation, is there any middleman or it is a group activity? Here you have having one-to-one relation. The rapport what you have with your father is one-to-one. The rapport what you have with your friend, it is not dependent on other friend or any other member of the society. These are one-to-one relations. And these relationships are where the real self is present. In this, the real self will be there. There will be no ostentatious and pretentious behavior. Even in friendship, there can be primary relations and also secondary relations. Now, the latest phenomena in the human history, Facebook friends. Some have lakhs of Facebook friends. Some have lakhs of Facebook followers. Whatever may be the thing, if it is maybe any relation, if it is not having these things, then it will be said to be a public relation, not a private relation. In private relation, the real self, what you are, is present. It is governed by internal control. It is governed by internal control, not any organization, rules, regulations, or anything. Governed by customs, traditions, religions, and trust. Right? This is exclusive of private relations. I have kept all the points in a bullet platform. You have to expand these things. If you find anything relevant, reasonable, please do add to this. Right? They have emotional bonds and interactions. They are context-free. What is do you mean by context-free? When you are in a public relation, there will be based on the context. If this is the context, you have to do like this. Because these are based on the rules and regulations other than the personal things. These are context-free, like in which context, in which time you meet, it will be the same almost. Say, for example, even they are beyond time also. You have got a very, very good friend, best friend. Think it, best friend. You meet your best friend after 10 years. Won't you have the same warmth? Say, for example, you are studying civil service. Fortunately, all of you became IAS. There is one of your friend, say, for example, like me, Raghu, he did not clear. If you are very good friends, even after you get service, there it will be context-free. He became IAS, it doesn't mean that he will treat you as a servant. So these are context-free. Right? Ethics in public relations. So private relations we have seen. Ethics in public relations. In public relations, you have got relation which is there in public sphere. Public relations involve relation between individuals in public sphere. They are formal in nature with legal or social obligation. So what is the main thing which is binding here? Here, legal or social relation, not individual relation. And these are not context free, they are context dependent. These are secondary relations, these are not primary relations. They are context dependent, they are very formal, they are not one to one, they are not face to face, they depend on the legal and social obligations. Next question to you to think is, can we distinguish all the relations into private and public relations? Okay, let me make you think. Husband and wife. All, they get registered. Their marriage get registered. They have got a son. This is also got registered. If we'll take the other way, think that things have changed. Wife is beating husband. Chances are there. Don't think it's always the only one direction. So wife is beating husband. Husband goes to police station. Oh. Say, for example, if you are in a very posh society like American or Western society, if there is like, if you are beating your son, this son will also go to police station. So here, do you think these are completely private relations? Or is there any element of public relation involved? While we are growing, we'll be brothers, very close, things like that. Will this relation be same even after 50 years? It is sometimes, it is these two brothers who are enemies, more antagonistic than any other person. Then can we consider this as a primary relation? The relation between our nephews, nice. When we were child, we were playing together. Then okay, want to meet intimate relation, context-free relation. Will that be same afterwards? Think it over. Think that this is private relation at one polar end. This is public relation at another polar. Try to locate these things on your own, in between, or any other thing. Where can we place these things? Two lovers, mother and child, colleagues from the same level. Here this is colleagues. On the other hand, employees and the boss. Whenever you see, like if a stranger wishes you, you also wish a stranger. When a DC or a collector with tribal people working on some development project, then they develop a rapport, personal rapport, student and teacher. Relation between two brothers as it proceeds in the life. Relation between husband and wife. Can we divide these relations into two watertight compartment as to private relations and public relations? Or can we say that no relation is 100% public? No relation is 100% private? All the relations fall in between two polar ends within this continuum. By now, you know the answer for this. Dear students, any relation for that matter, a very, very important thing, this is the one which is missing in your answers. Right? Distinguishing between private and public relation is very vague, ambiguous, and difficult thing. It is an exercise in futility. if you want to demarcate two things into watertight compartment as to public and private relations, it is difficult. Not possible in many cases. All relations cannot be located at two polar ends, one representing the private and another representing. What is the meaning? Means all fall in between these two polar ends. Polar ends. Is this clear to you? Means we cannot make any distinction. Say, for example, your father gets 100 hectares of land from his father. After some time, so you have grown up, you got married, and you have family. So, what will you do if your father hesitates to give this 100 acres? We'll go to court of law. And you say, see, this 100 acres you have not earned on your own. According to law, this we are also having equal share in these things. It's what happening. So there is nothing like 100% private or public. They fall between two continuum. This is very important thing which I have to internalize. One of the most important committee we have discussed, that is Nolan Committee. This is the committee on which all the ethical standards in public relations are built. This is one of the earliest, all-encompassing one, right? Very important. This is with respect to your life in public, not private. So the committee name itself was Committee on Standards in Public Life. I repeat, Committee on Standards in Public Life. This is popularly known as Nolan Committee because Nolan was the chairman of the committee. So if I say Nolan also, it's not wrong, right? This committee's recommendation were far-reaching. It was the one of the earliest. Even your second ARC recommendations in a greater extent are dependent on this. When second ARC was recommending foundational values or values for civil service, it took into consideration the Nolan Committee recommendation, and it has explicitly mentioned this aspect. So here, with respect to Nolan Committee, there is one way to remember, that is with respect to an acronym, you can say. Sahel O means there are seven things there, each letters representing one. So you can remember, or otherwise you can come up on your own, some acronym. Sahil O. If you remember that, I suppose you can just reproduce these things. So what are these? These are the things. Selflessness, accountability, honesty, integrity, leadership, objectivity, openness. So these are the things required for, or the, these are the ethical standards in public life, public relations. Dear students, so here generally you will be having idea as to what these things are in a general context, but you should have a fair understanding of what these are in public relations. I once again stress upon, whenever you are a civil servant, whenever you are in a public relation, these are the things which you have to follow. And the meaning of these things you have to take according to the committee. Selflessness. Here, selflessness directly means that you should act in public interest. not self interest, not individual interest, not personal interest. Are you getting me? Say, for example, with respect to integrity, you should not place yourself in such a position that you go away from the established standards of an organization. This is what integrity is when you are in public life. Integrity in general is different. When you are acting in an organization, it is different. Selflessness in public life means acting according to public interest. So let me explain these things in the words of Nolan. According to Nolan committee, selflessness means taking decisions solely in terms of public interest. Is it clear? Selflessness means don't write all the stories. What does selflessness mean? Just acting solely in terms of public interest. To elaborate that, holders of public office should take decisions solely in terms of public interest. They should not do so in order to gain financial or other material benefits for themselves, their family, or their friends. Right? This is what is selflessness in public life. Right? Next, accountability. Accountable for one's decisions and action to the public must submit themselves to scrutiny. So what is accountability? According to Nolan, accountability means when you are in public life, you should be accountable to the decisions what you have taken, the actions what you have taken to the public. So the ultimate accountability, as I told, will be the public. And you should submit yourself to any scrutiny. The holders of public office are accountable for their decisions and actions to the public and must submit themselves to whatever scrutiny is appropriate to their office. Right? This is accountability in public life. Next, with respect to duty, honesty. What does honesty mean in public life? Duty to declare any private interest, resolve any conflict to protect the public interest. Honesty means the holders of public office have a duty to declare any private interest relating to their public duties. So why? This prevents conflict of interest. When you declare that you have got a private interest there, this is the first stage of eliminating a conflict of interest. Holders of public office have a duty to declare any private interest relating to their public duties and to take steps to resolve any conflict arising in a way that protects the public interest. So, and you have to take steps to resolve any conflict arising in such a way that it protects the public interest. See here, we have two components. What is being honest in public relations means? Means you have to straight away say the private interest what you have in relation to your public duty. Then there will be private interests. In that scenario, you have to resolve the conflict between private interest and public interest in such a way that public interest is upheld. You have to take steps to resolve any conflict arising in such a way that protects the public interest, not the private interest. Integrity should not place themselves under any obligation to outside individuals or organizations. So what does this mean? It means please don't take any money. Please don't accept any gift. Please don't involved in any relations which compel you to do something out of your duty. Right? So that is the reason why one of the things they have kept is, say, for example, extramarital relations, all these things. Why? Because if you have all those things, you can't have integrity. Because you will be placing yourself under the obligation from outside thing. Maybe anything, maybe lust, money, or anything for that matter. Holders of the public office should not place themselves under any official or other obligation to outside individuals or organizations that might influence them in the performance of their official duties. This is integrity. The thing which we have studied, integrity means following ethical standards. It is in general. So following his ethical standards is integrity. Here, in this regard, you should follow the rules and regulation, ethical standards, values, code of conduct. You can do that only when you don't have any obligation for anything outside the organization. If you have got any obligation, say for example, you have taken 1 crore rupee, then definitely you have obligation. You have taken a flat from one individual, definitely obligation. Or somehow you have joined in a posh club where the membership itself is a status symbol for you. So you will be there in an obligation. So you should not place yourself under any obligation. Objectivity means should make the choices on merit. To elaborate this, in carrying out public businesses, including making public appointments, awarding contracts, or recommendations, individuals for reward and benefits, holders of public office should make choices on merit. Oh, make choices on merit is a very, very important thing. No, you should not miss. If you are making choices on merit, it means that there should not be any partiality. It means there should be impartiality, non-partisanship. Right? Objectivity, crux, merit. Openness. As open as possible about all the decisions and action they take. So which is the concept which I have discussed already with respect to openness? It is transparency. Openness, like there will be some person, this person is very open, means they will be telling whatever comes to their mind without any like hesitation. There will be others who will be transforming, who will be modifying, and who will be telling the thing according to the needs of the situation. Openness means transparency. For transparency, you have to add this aspect also. As open as possible about all the decisions and actions they take. They should give reasons for their decisions. Restrict information only when the wider public interest clearly demands. So, you should restrict information. You should be opaque. You should, like there can be a chance of secrecy. When can an institution, public institution, work in secrecy? It can work in secrecy only for public interest. If the larger public interest demands, okay, there is no need to be open. There is no need for transparency. So openness means being transparent. See, if the things are transparent, can we, like, will it be possible for us to do something fishy? If there is something, some area, you take anything, any area. If it is not transparent, if it is not open, if there is something, some secret place, what people do in secret places, there will be something which is wrong. So if the things are there, transparent, then the things will be fair to a greater extent. Holders of public office should be as open as possible about all the decisions and action they take. They should give reasons for their decisions and restrict information only when the wider public interest clearly demands. Right? Leadership. This is one of the important things here. Whenever you are in a public office, you should have a leadership quality. And very important point, before you are filling, like for mains, for mains, and also before you go for interview, there will be one thing known as DAF. Previously, this was not there. Recently, they have come up with this abbreviation, detailed application form. In this detailed application form, they will be asking a lot of things, personal details about you. In this regard, you have to show all these characters which we have dealt with. Majorly, the leadership thing, because as a public servant, as a civil servant, you are in a leadership role. Say, for example, I was the class leader in 10th standard. I was the class representative in my graduation. I was the team leader for my team. I was the captain of my college cricket team. However small they may be, you have to mention that. It shows that you already have played a leadership role. Dear students, if you are a captain many times, you will be aware of these things. And there will be many, many people who will never be captains, won't be leaders in their life. Class representative, monitor. Their way of thinking, their way of attitude is one which is to follow, not to guide, not to lead. You should be a person who should be willing to take the bullet on your chest. You should lead from front. Not only that, in many cases, you have to lead from behind also. You have to lead your juniors. You have to delegate the work, ask them to learn. Leadership qualities, wherever possible, in your detailed application form, which you will be filling if you clear prelims. If you are going to interview, in that you have to carefully write all your things in such a way that you are reflecting the qualities needed for a civil servant. So this is an exam to choose a candidate for civil services. So you should project those things, and you should not project those things which are antagonistic to the characters with respect to civil servant, right? So here, holders of public office should promote and support these principles, means all this which we have discussed, by leadership and by example. Means you should influence leadership. What is a very important character of a leader? Is influencing others. Means you should influence them. You should lead by example. You should be the person who will be selfless, who will be showing accountability, honesty, integrity, objectivity, all these things. So you should lead by leadership and with example. So Sahil O. By this, you can just make out all the things. Selfless, please concentrate here. Selfless means taking decisions solely in public interest. Accountability means accountable to public and submitting to scrutiny. Honesty, duty to declare any private interest, resolve any conflict to protect the public interest. Integrity, you should not place yourself under any other obligation. Leadership is to lead by examples and leadership, objectivity, choices based on merit, openness, to be open as much as possible and give reasons for your decisions, restrict information only in public interest. These are the ethical standards in public relations, right? Ethics in public and private relations. Then let me ask you a question in this regard. It is said that whatever happens in privacy does not hurt anyone. What do you think? Whatever you do within the four walls, it does not hurt anyone. And it is said that the motto of Las Vegas is that whatever happens in Las Vegas, stay in Vegas. It means that Las Vegas was one of the places where people always used to go and enjoy. Means there used to be many things like drug burglars, prostitution, women, all these things. So here people used to go, they used to enjoy, and they used to say that whatever happens in Las Vegas, or they stay in Vegas itself. Means you can go to Las Vegas and do whatever you want, all the nonsense things, and come back. Means those all nonsense things are lost in Vegas itself. They won't come with you. For this, what is your opinion? See here, you have to link this to one of the case study where one of your superior was involved in, like say, domestic violence. You can draw conclusions and also inferences by these things. So here, very important thing, according to David Gill, it is impossible to maintain a clear and precise distinction between private and public relations. Why? Very important. See here, first of all, point number one, you cannot define clearly the 100% this is a private relation and this is a public relation. First one. The second thing is, it is impossible to maintain a clear and precise distinction in this relationship because no individual behavior is without social implication. No individual behavior is without social implication, society at large, society, and no societal situation or problem is without individual repercussions. To say that you are living in a larger society, social, this is society, this is you individual. Individual cannot live in isolation. Whatever there in the society influences the individual. Whatever there in the individual influences the society. Is it clear? So we cannot say, we cannot distinguish ethics and in private and public relation into two watertight compartments. For two things. One is, you cannot distinguish precisely as to what is private and public relation. And at the same time, private relations and public relations influence each other. No individual behavior without social implications. And no social situation or problem is without individual repercussions. Whatever happens in society affects you. Whatever you as an individual do will affect the society in the larger extent. This is the thing. Right? To conclude, you have to take this stand that it is impossible to maintain a clear and precise distinction between private and public relations, number one. Along with that, society, societal things influence individual, individual things affect society also, right? Next topic, human values, role of family, society, educational institution in inculcating values. Dear students, as you are aware, Ethics is a reflective science. Ethics is a reflexive styles. You have to reflect on what you have done, how the things have happened. You have got certain values. How did you get those values? How did you get those values? So for example, a very strange thing, in fact, I noticed when I was in Hyderabad, there was some X person X. He was not speaking to any individual who is not from his community. He's not from, say for example, he's from a community. Say for example, he belongs to some community. He's speaking to only this community people. Where did he get this value? There is another person. He never takes heritage products. He was in fact my roommate. So heritage milk, heritage, he never takes. Even if it is for 1 kilometer, he used to go 1 kilometer and he used to take non-heritage products. Why did he get this? Where did he get this? Is it from family? Is it from society? Is it from educational institution? What are the differences in inculcating the values? Who is more important? Who is less important? When are they more important? When are they less important? Dear students, here, all these things and the interrelated thing, you have to see with respect to the concept of your LPG, globalization, industrialization, urbanization. Is the role of family, society, and educational institutions changing over a period of time? Or is it the same? Previously, when I was a child, or still some, like when my father will go to their era, some 50 years back, or some 100 years back, most of the children, they aspire to become as their father. Aspire to become as their father. Their father was their biggest hero. They were inspired by that. Not only that, some 100 years before, family was the unit of production. Unit of production. Means all the members of the family used to act as one unit to produce some things. Whether even in case of agriculture, are the things same? In these times, there was nothing like Chiranjeevi, Shah Rukh Khan, Amitabh Bachchan. They were never their heroes. Virat Kohli was never their hero. Things are changing. What is the role of family, society, and educational institution in this regard? Let me decipher some of the uncommon things in this regard. Let me brief the things which I have already studied. Values are those which are important. If it is important for a person, it becomes personal value. If it is important for society, it becomes societal value. Right? Personal values, societal values, the values which are prized by all. The values which are prized by all are called core values. Values which are present in most of the societies are called as core values or universal values. Say, for example, truth, honesty, these are universal values. Compassion, integrity, These are universal values or eternal values. We just read these things. Core values are the values which are basic to the whole humanity. The whole humanity needs these things. Expected to follow by every human being under normal circumstances. These are also known as eternal, which live, which never die. These are universal example: truth, love, compassion, moral integrity, etc. Don't you agree with me? Is there any society which says the truth is not desirable? Even he may be a big gunda, even if he is a big thief, do that thief want his daughter, his son, to get married with another big thief? Even the most corrupt person has a great respect for the person who is truthful. Why? Because these are universal values. Instrumental value, terminal value. See here, I have listed many terminal and instrumental values. I will be giving the handouts as of now. I will be giving only few. Instrument means what? Why you are using bicycle? To move from one place to another place. Why am I using this pen? To communicate with you. So this is an instrument. Means this is not the end. Terminal means this is the end. There are some values which are means to achieve the ends, and these are called instrumental value, or they're also called extrinsic value, means outside. So instrument are extrinsic. On the other hand, they have terminal values which are end in themselves. So they are intrinsic, means they are present in them itself. Instrumental values, money. Money is the instrument. Cleanliness, courage, politeness. These are the instrumental values through which it leads to other values. See, in answering the questions in ethics, these are some of the things which you have to keep in mind. About, say, for example, about the importance of money, about the importance of cleanliness, courage, politeness. So money, is money important? The question comes, then you have to say, see, this is one of the value. It is an instrumental value through which we can achieve other values. So in fact, it is useful as an instrumental value, but it is not an end in itself. This is just a tool. Right? On the other hand, we have got terminal values like true friendship, matured love, self-respect, happiness, equality, and freedom. So these are terminal values. These are end in themselves. Self-respect, happiness, equality, freedom. All of us aspire to have a lot of freedom. Freedom in itself is a terminal value. Right? So these are the things. So you please internalize these things without any hesitation or doubt, because this I have taken from very standard books. According to them, these are the terminal values which are end in themselves. Because we do get some doubts as to how it is terminal, like that. Okay. Next is, can humans be without values? Can humans be without values? If not guided by the values, what will happen? We often like ask questions whether values exist in our society. We often hear a son has thrown her mother into street or somewhere because of property. a friend has circulated a very like immoral video of our girlfriend in the social media. A child was found in dustbin. A student killed his teacher. These kind of examples make us to think whether there is anything like values or not. Dear students, humans, for anyone to be called as human, there is a very, very important thing, that is value. If an animal is not guided by value, if it is not guided by value, then it is not human. So if not guided by the values, there won't be any difference between the humans and animals. We often come across the situations, we often come across and see in newspaper, and we wonder whether values exist in our society or not. All our actions, deeds should be guided by the supreme ethical standards, should be guided by values. In this chapter, you have got inculcation of values, role of family, society, and educational institutions in inculcation of values. What do you understand by inculcation of values? Inculcation of values means to fix or instill values firmly in someone's mind, especially by repeating it often. So, what is the meaning of inculcation? Inculcation is an active process of putting something in others' head. Inculcating values means it is not like something which is flowing into you passively. Someone is installing in you, someone is putting that in your mind firmly by repeating it. According to you, something is right, something is wrong, something is just, something is unjust. These are the values which have been inculcated in you by the family, society, and educational institutions. For those of you who have done graduation, who have stayed in hostels, most of the time, there won't be barriers with respect to caste or anything. So here, there is one value which has been inculcated. The same person, when he goes to his village, he may be having some like casteist mentality. Educational institutions, society, and family are the major components which inculcate values. Because these are the institutions which have given the authority, which have the power, and also which have the luxury of inculcating some of the things by repeating it again and again. So inculcation means putting something, some values, installing values firmly in your mind by repeating it. So the crux is to fix, to instill some values. Most of the time, it is by repeating again and again. What is institution? Family, society, religion, state, or even the education system. Are these institutions? I repeat, can we call family as an institution? Can we call society, religion, state, or even the education as an institution? The answer for this is yes. family, society, religion, state, education, or institutions. If they are institutions, why they are called institutions? Why they are called institutions? Anything can be called as an institution when there is a pattern, when there's a definite pattern. When can there be a definite pattern? When it is run based on certain rules and regulations, based on certain customs, traditions. Means underneath the thing, there is something concrete based on which the whole thing is resting. Say, for example, family. You have got certain rules. Society, there are some customs, traditions, religion. Isn't it? Are you getting the meaning of institution? So, family is an institution, society is an institution. Why? Because an institution is something that works according to rules established or at least acknowledged by law or customs. In institution, there will be something which are in the form of rules, norms, customs, according to which they are run. So family is an institution because it runs according to some certain rules, some customs, some traditions, some norms. Right? So institution is one which works according to certain rules, customs, traditions, anything like that. Since it is working according to certain rules, customs, traditions, and norms, there comes a certain pattern, right? Okay. Institutions impose constraints on individuals. At the same time, they also provide him or her with opportunities. So, institutions provide opportunities and at the same time they impose some restrictions. Take for example family, society, or education institutions or anything. They provide knowledge, they provide shelter, they give the warmth, what you need in a group. At the same time you have got some restrictions. You cannot do whatever you want to feel, right? An institution can also be viewed as an end in itself. Example, family, society, religion. Institution, in many cases, can be viewed as an end in itself, not as a means. This is a very, very important table, though it is not in a tabular form. Dear students, okay, let me make this a table. According to Maurice Marie, a sociologist, value formation, how values are formed, depends on these three stages. According to the sociologist, after birth till 7 years, it will be imprint period. Imprint means just whatever you print on that one, there will be there. Just internalize the words. Literal meaning is more than sufficient here. I have given the detailed description in the notes. You can go through that. 8 to 13, here there will be a period of modeling period. In the first period, just whatever they're imprinted, whatever they say, whatever you see, you're taking that as it is. In the second period, you are not taking everything as it comes. You are coming up, you are trying, why this? Why that? This is a period of modeling. And 13 to 21, it is a period of socialization. Socialization means preparing an individual, preparing a biological animal, preparing a biological animal to a social being who is capable of living in the society. So making an animal live in a society is socialization. So we'll discuss those things. And at the same time, very, very important, you have to impose this on the three things which are given in the syllabus. First is imprint period, second modeling, third is socialization. Similarly, we have got family, educational institution, and society. What is the role in this? Who will be present in this 1 to 7 years? Is family more, education institution more, or the society? Between 13 to 21 years, who is influencing, who will be influencing more? We have to reflect on those things, right? To begin with, family. These are fairly simple, fairly easy, common sense things. I'll be going a little fast here. Group of people related by blood, marriage, law, or custom related to family. Family is an institution. It is a universal social institution. Family is a team. Perhaps no other social entity appears more natural than family. What family is varies from society to society, but family is universal. Please internalize this one. Family is universal, means family is present in all societies. Throughout humanity, throughout the world, you have the institution of family. By this, you can gauge the importance. There is no society where there is no family. Family is such an institution which happens naturally. No other thing comes that naturally. Say marriage. Is there anything which comes naturally? Marriage is also a universal phenomena. But it's not that natural. Perhaps in a society, if there is something which is more natural, then it is inevitably family. When it comes to family, we act as a team. We act as a team. We feel that, what is the meaning of this team? Means, if we win, the whole team will win. If we lose, the whole team will be losing. To elaborate on that, say for example, cricket team. Say for example, Virat Kohli. He got man of the match. Think like that. Can we say that the Indian team has won? Or can we say that Virat Kohli has won? No. Think that India has lost the match. Virat Kohli is announced the man of the match. Think like that. Even if he is a high scorer, whatever may be the case, still Virat Kohli has lost. This teamwork is also present in your Council of Ministers. Council of Ministers act as a team. There is no individual identity is the inner meaning. When you are in team, there is no individual identity. The identity which you have is only the team identity. If the team wins, you will also win. If the team loses, you will also be losing. Right? So it's an institution, it's a universal, it's a team, it's a natural, it's based on blood, marriage, law, and customs. Role of family in inculcating the values. In the chart which you saw, it was the first stage. First stage was the imprint period. In this, family members are the only people who are present. Up to the age of 7, we are like sponges. We are like sponges absorbing everything around us, accepting much of it as true, especially when it comes to our parents. Till the age of 7, we'll be absorbing everything as true. Say for example, I am from one community, I'll be criticizing another community. I feel that yes, this is true. They say that this community is very arrogant. I feel this is true. They say that Pakistan is not a friendly country. We'll take that as true. Think that the father is taking bribe. We take that has to be some ethical standard. We think that that is acceptable. Taking bribe, there is nothing wrong in that. We feel like that. Why? Because it was thought like that. And in those cases, if someone is saying something, but he's doing the other thing, the child will be in confusion. Say, for example, mother, father, they said that like, they will be beating you or they will be telling you, don't tell lie. Sometimes they say, see, if you do wrong, it's okay, but you should not tell lie. So the child thinks, yes, this is true. Even if I do something wrong, I should not tell lie. I have to just report, even if they punish me. In other circumstance, say for example, a person has given money to your father. He has come to your house and he asks your mother. Mother says that no, husband is not here, he went outside. Then the child will be in confusion. What is this true in one situation is not true in another situation. Father will be at home. On phone, he'll be saying, sir, I am almost near the office. Or I just came to the office and I have just like come for a chai. I'll be there in another 10 minutes. First stage is very, very important. Here, whatever happens in the first 7 years, children will take that as true. So the role of family in inculcating values is very, very important, very, very crucial. Because it is the imprint period. Whatever is happening, they just simply take those things as true. Right? Family is the foundation on which the values are built. Family is the cornerstone of the society. Human society cannot function without family. Family is the first form of citizenship, and mother is the first and most important teacher of a child. Family is a bond that is unbreakable. They say that blood is very thick. Blood is very thick. In many instances, especially for teenagers of new generation, they are more influenced by some of the values, some of the things from social media or anything like that. Because of that, say for example, a person is coming up with large beard saying that NTR, my role model, is doing like that. That may not be accepted by the family. Or he learns some habits, some things. So in a way, there will be conflict between the members of the family. Even then, why we stick to it? Because it is an unbreakable thing. Say, for example, your friend. You have been friends for the last 10 years, but he does something wrong in one instance. So what do you say? Just get out from my life. Finish friendship. Can this happen with family? No. In some of the cases, family members are the most irritating people. But we'll be together. We say, like, it is a necessary evil. It's unbreakable. Knowingly or unknowingly, dear students, family, especially mother, is the first teacher. We learn many things. We cannot think of society. We cannot think of society without family. Society, you can consider this as a biryani, or for those vegetarians, palav. Each grain in this is a family. If all the grains are good, then the society will also be good. If the individual things are not good, then how can you expect the society to be good? Family also plays a very important role when the child reaches the school age. Why? How? The child can only enroll, attend school regularly, practice in after-school activities with the assistance of family. Do you agree? Otherwise, it's not possible. If there is someone who is beating a children, who will protect them? It is a family. Family provides a protective environment. There'll be, you might have seen, there'll be some small children, they'll beat another child and they'll just run away to their family because it's protective, they protect. Not only in this regard, in many respects. Whatever you might have done, at the end, they want to protect you. Child who are healthy, well-nourished and protected from abuse and exploitation are better prepared to learn. If a child is unhealthy, malnourished, being exploited, do you think it has got a higher chance of learning? No. Family also plays a very, very important role even in the life of an adolescent, because this is a very, very strange stage where you will be between two important things. That is, you are not yet adult. At the same time, you are not a child. Because there will be some things, not only mentally, physically also, some conspicuous things which make you tell that you are not a child. And even sometimes you may become aggressive also if someone says, you child or childish. You say, like, you are getting mustache, your height is increasing. Many things are happening. So you won't be considering yourself as a child. At the same time, you are not an adult. You may not be having the resources, the recognition, the mental stability. So this is a stage where you are not an adult and also not a child. Families are central in enabling adolescents to develop their fullest. Adolescence is also the period of transition when adolescents start to turn their attention away from home and start contributing to society. So here, when you are getting adult, in the adolescence period, you have already started contributing to the society. You have already started thinking independently, getting the money, earning. You have got a greater autonomy, but you are no longer a child and also you are not yet an adult. Family plays a role in, very important role in inculcating the values. This can be said to be in the form of socialization. This socialization, it can be made in a diverse ways. Socialization, primary socialization, anticipatory socialization, pre-socialization. Socialization, a precise definition, is a process of transformation of human infant from a biological animal into a social individual. So, transformation from biological animal into a social individual is called socialization. Socialization includes all those processes through which individuals internalize social skills, roles, patterns, values, personality type from childhood till the old age. So family inculcates, well, plays a very important role by socializing. In this primary socializing, here, preparing you before you are left to the society. Anticipatory socialization, this year, family is anticipating some of the problems and also some of the opportunities which you may get. For that, it is socializing. Right? Say, for example, family expects that if you are known as a person of some good character, you have got a very high chance of getting married. So they will anticipate that and they will want to bring that in. And re-socialization. If in society, if something goes wrong, and if you are not capable of balancing with the customs and traditions of the society, then family is the one which modifies, refines you. It re-socializes you so that you will become part of a society. Next important question is, like, is family dying? Is family dying? Life has changed so much for most of us with industrialization, with urbanization, the advancement of technology, changing of cultural norms. New priorities have come, new forms of communication fueled with the internet. In all these contexts, is the family a dying institution that has no place in modern life? Think it over. Is family playing the same role? Is family playing an increasing role, a decreasing role, or no role at all? Is family a dying institution? The answer is certainly not. Family is just as relevant as it was. No matter how much life changes in future, it will probably continue to be the need in one's own life. The definition of family is evolving. There is no universal definition of family, but the importance of family remains. What family means, the definition is evolving. Long before family meant like joint family, things like that. Now the definition is changing, evolving. It is varying from place to place. But family will be relevant in the future also, whatever may be the thing. This, I will give more inputs in the fag end when we discuss the impact with respect to globalization, industrialization, all these things. Then role of education institutions. Think it over. What are the values which have been inculcated? Name the values which have been inculcated in you by the education institutions. Think of those values which were in conflict with the values which have been taught in your family. In your family, there is such a values. But we come across some of the values which are in conflict with the values which have been inculcated in you by the education institution. One most apparent thing which you often see is our attitude towards the caste system. Attitude towards caste system. We have many of our best friends who are not from our own caste. We treat many of all of these people almost equally. We never consider like superior or inferior. We never had anything like untouchability. So what is the role of educational institution here? One important thing which you have to consider when it comes to the role of educational institution is here there is a unique relation, and educational institutions are the unique places. Why? Because you are going to those institutions. You are going to institution. You will be trained by some individual who is a master, or whom the society or other thinks that he is a master. Teacher, student relation. You are going to acquire knowledge, experience, wisdom here. Along with that, knowingly or unknowingly, you will be acquiring some of the values. Dear students, the value of equality of the castes and religions which has come to your mind has not come on its own. It has been inculcated in you. It has been inculcated in you. Say, for example, we have got a patriarchal society where always we feel that man is the head of the family. Wife, like, okay, next, secondary role. But in your education system, in your colleges, they will show you that we are all equal. Is there anyone who feels that they are superior or inferior than to the other sex? To a greater extent, no. Here, it's a unique place. Let me give some of the things here, the same table, here too. Very important thing is, after 6 years, we'll be joining the school. In fact, in reality, first standard, second standard, this is the area in which it will be more implying to you. How, dear students, education institutions reinforce the values which are already formed in the first stage. Teachers have a significant role to play. Here, if teachers show double standards, things like if they tell something and if they do something, student will be in confusion. Education institution reinforce the things. Education is a lifelong process where all the experience, knowledge, and wisdom that an individual acquires. Dear students, education institutions should inculcate discipline, punctuality, equality. Education institutions will include these things, knowingly or unknowingly. You are wearing a uniform over a period of time. Unknowingly, these are the things which brings equality. In your college, in your class, your standard, your reputation depends not on the caste to a greater extent, but how talented are you? Always there'll be one thing in the school or college, one timings, all have to come to that. So educational institutions teach everyone, inculcate everyone discipline, punctuality, equality. And this is in addition to the main things for what we go, along with the experience, knowledge, and wisdom. Unfortunately, in some of the education institutions, they are giving more importance to knowledge and wisdom, and they are least bothered about these things. This should not happen. And education institutions are the places where you will be getting a very, very important virtue, that is tolerance. You'll be exposed to different people. You'll come to know what the word is, how people react. Otherwise, you won't be having like how people of other religion work, how they do, what they do. Not only religion, people of other caste. Coming to the role of education institutions, here it has got two important functions. One is manifest, which is open and it is visible to you. Another is latent, which is a hidden function. So I have already given the clue to you. What are the manifest functions which are open? What are the hidden functions of an education institution? The manifest functions, the open functions in this regard include communication of information, transmission of knowledge, socializing, preparing for future occupation, an engineer will prepare for future occupation, fosters participatory democracy. These are openly stated things, but there are other functions also which are latent or hidden, which should also be taken care. What are these? Transmitting of our culture, promoting social and political integration, maintenance of social control, serving as agents of change, create social harmony, a tool of social change. These are some of the hidden things. Unknowingly, you will be transmitted to these things. On the other hand, there are many things which are explicitly mentioned. Why you are going to school, college? To acquire knowledge, to prepare yourself for the future. Right? Then, role of society in inculcating values. What is society? Dear students, society is group of people. Society, to begin with, to make things clear to you, society refers to people. This is society. The way of life of these people is known as culture. So this should be the crux, the basis on which you can build upon the things. Right? Society refers to people. Here, these people, say for example, group of passengers who are waiting in a bus stand. Can we call this as a society? Yes, at the crux is, so society means group of people. We can add some other important things also to this. What are they? Society is a group of people, a group of individuals involved in persistent social interaction, repeated social interaction, or a large social group sharing the same geographical area. So, the bare minimum for a society is group of people who have persistent interaction or living in a given area. Or you can combine these two and make society is group of people living in a geographical area consisting of persistent social interactions. This is very important. In this, society's major impact will be after, to a greater extent, in this 13 to 21 years. You will be exposed to society from the beginning itself. But to a greater extent, your influence will be in the third stage. Because as a child till seven years, family influence will be very, very high. Till the age of 30, there will be influence, but it will be not the influence of the society. It will be more of your primary relations. We follow peer and media exert a greater influence in this. These are the elements of society. When you take if any question arises, how society influences or the role played by society in inculcating values, you have to put all these things. Friends, neighbors, media, films, religion, leader, government. All these things are the elements of society. Society inculcates values through socialization. As you are aware, socialization is a process of transforming the human infant from a biological animal into a social individual. So, transforming a biological animal into a social individual is called socialization. Second is internalization. Society plays a very, very important role in internalizing the sins. In internalizing is to make them as one part and parcel of you. Man internalizes the norms and values of a given society, and the degree of socialization decides the level of conformity with the existing practice. It is through society that you internalize the norms, the unwritten rules of the society, values, the things which society feels are important. These are internalized by society. And the degree of socialization, to what degree you are socialized, decides the level of conformity with the existing practices. Less socialization, less conformity. Then indoctrination. Indoctrination is a process through which societal norms are injected into the personality of a child. So here it is an active process where society is injecting the things, indoctrinating you. In the first one, you have internalized the norms and values. In the next thing, there is an indoctrination of some of the values into your personality by the society. Next is social control. This is a very, very important thing. Social control is very, very high. A very important aspect is, as we go from simple society to complex society, social control decreases. Say, for example, this is a village. In this village, I think that I am a Muslim. The chances of me marrying any Christian or any Hindu, is it high or low? Generally low. In a village, the chances of me wearing some posh dress, modern dress, doing some posh things always, say, for example, different hairstyle and getting PhD in any areas, wherever I want. So these are the things which I won't be doing in the village, simple society. You take the other thing, say, for example, modern, urban metro cities, Shah Rukh Khan, what is the religion of his spouse? Amir Khan. Okay, we cannot take Salman Khan. It's a very complex situation. Okay, Saif Ali Khan. Why? Because social control decreases from a simple society to complex society. But there is social control always. Don't you agree? The way you dress, the things you do are controlled by society. Social control and self-control are complementary to one another. Child observes the environment and follows what it observes. Social control is the control exerted by the society. The control exerted by the people. Your peer group, don't you think they exert pressure? It exerts pressure. Role of education institutions, family, society in inculcating the values. With industrialization, urbanization, the advancement of technology, changing cultural norms, new priorities, and new forms of communication fueled by the internet. In all these things, the role of family in the era of LPG, globalization, in the era of internet, the role of family is increasingly decreasing. The role of family is decreasing. The role of society is increasing, but it's in another form. It's now we have got new priorities, new ways in which we get influenced. Role of educational institution is increasing. Let me give a brief idea with respect to these things. See, just in a very simplified way, I will tell you, industrialization. What is industrialization? Industrialization is a process where goods and services are produced in a place which is known as industry. Why this name? Because previously goods and services were produced in something known as home. Home used to be the place of production, unit of production. Because of industrialization, because of urbanization, things have changed a lot. Previously, husband, wife, son, they all used to live in the same house. They used to work in the same house. They used to produce the same goods. Son used to follow what the father says. Son used to follow the same profession. Goldsmith, son always will be a goldsmith. The person who is in contract business will be in contract business. Farmer, son, farmer. Then your father, your mother, they used to be your heroes. You used to look for your father and mother whenever you need some assistance, whenever you need some knowledge. Now, the son is no more following the same profession. So they are no more looking for knowledge. They are looking for some other individual, maybe your teacher, professor, some celebrity. The equations have changed. Previously, since it was the unit of production, there used to be oneness. There used to be some understanding, some intimacy. Now, as soon as they wake up, father will go in one direction, mother will go in another direction for work. In this journey itself, if you are in metro, minimum 1 hour, minimum. Means in this 24 hours, minimum 2 to 3 hours you are lost in driving. Afterwards, you finish major part of your life you are spending in factory or industry or organization. Afterwards, you will come back. The equations have changed. So in the era of industrialization, globalization, with the advancement of technology, the role and importance of family is decreasing, but never zero, never zero, because things are changing, right? These are some of the important things which have to keep in mind with respect to these topics. So these are the things. I would like to know if we have got any doubt with respect to the things which we have discussed.